Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 31st meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to agree or not to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. Agenda item 2 is to consider whether or not to take our next meeting, which is to be held on Thursday the 12th of January, in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed on that too. Thank you. The principal item of business for the committee this morning is to consider the Auditor General for Scotland's Section 22 report on the 2021-22 audit of National Records of Scotland. And can I welcome our witnesses this morning? The last time you gave evidence to the committee, you were remote. So I'm very pleased to welcome both Graeme Sampson into the committee room. Graeme's a senior auditor with Audit Scotland, with Darshi Sansakarman, who's an audit manager with Audit Scotland, and of course the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle. Very welcome. We've got some questions to ask you on the Section 22 report. First of all, Auditor General, can I invite you to make an opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, members. I am presenting today's report on the 2021-22 audit of the National Records of Scotland under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. Convener, I've prepared this Section 22 report to update Parliament on progress since my report on the 2020-21 audit, which highlighted the challenges that NRS was facing with delivery of the census programme and the financial impact of the decision to delay the census to March 2022, given the COVID-19 pandemic. Since I last reported, the census went live as planned in February, but achieved a response rate lower than the 90% target. NRS decided to extend the collection until the end of May, resulting in an overall response rate of 89%. NRS estimates that the extension will add a further £6 million to the lifetime costs of the census programme, and the Cabinet Secretary agreed to fund this additional expenditure. NRS is taking steps to mitigate the impact of the lower than expected response rate on the quality and robustness of census outputs, including the decision by the Registrar General to establish an international steering group of experts to provide support and guidance. NRS is confident that it is still on track to produce high quality census outputs, but it will now be more reliant than originally planned on the use of administrative data to support the production of its population estimates. It is important, therefore, that NRS continues to be transparent as it progresses the significant remaining work to conclude the census programme. Convener, as ever, my colleagues and I look forward to answering the committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed for that helpful opening introduction to the report. Can I just begin by asking a factual question, really? So the report talks about something called the Census Coverage Survey. And first of all, could I ask you to explain to us what that is?
Yes, Convener, I'll start actually, and I'm sure Darshi might want to come in and comment further. So we refer to census coverage survey in the report, and this is effectively a survey-taking exercise that takes place after the completion of the original census. Darshi can say a bit further, but effectively it looks to explore some of the returns and some of the reasons why people didn't participate in the survey exercise, to in part understand people's choices, some of the behaviours and data. And we highlight in the paper that it goes in to explore, you know, some of the breakdown as to, you know, people said why they didn't complete the survey, the most significant explanation given that they were too busy to, along with a host of other reasons why they didn't complete it. Before going into any more detail, Kavira, I think it's an interesting point overall in terms of survey results, is that whilst the overall return rate for the main census was below target and also below the survey results from the 2011 survey, that's similar to what we've seen from the The following survey results that also are lower in terms of people's completion and behaviour rates. I may have said more than you wish, convener, so I'll pause actually and ask if there's any Darcy wants to add.
Yes, so just to clarify, so the census coverage survey is something that is used in Scotland, but also in the rest of the UK and in other countries. They use a similar methodology to follow up from the census, and it's essentially about filling some of the gaps to identify some of the number of households and some of the characteristics of the households and individuals that didn't respond to the census itself. So the sample size is roughly about 1.5% of the population. and so there's actually, there was a separate survey that NRS did, a smaller survey that was exploring some of the reasons for people not responding. The coverage survey is part of the standard census methodology to help provide more information about the population for the census estimates.
Okay, so but if I look at so the return rates from memory in England, Wales, Northern Ireland were about 97%, were they? So their census coverage survey, did that focus on the reasons why the 3% didn't respond, or did that have a wider role to play in giving more qualitative information about the census returns?
So the coverage survey itself is not so much about the reasons as about providing, it's part of the methodology to provide information about the households that didn't complete the census, but it's not about the reasons, if that makes sense. So there are three pillars, as the International Steering Group describe it, of the census methodology. There's the census itself, there's the coverage survey, and then there's the use of administrative data. And those three things together combined are used to produce the population estimates and to quality assure those estimates.
Okay, well, I mean, can I turn now to administrative data, because the committee took evidence earlier this year, and I think at the end, let me just check my dates, it was at the end of last year we took evidence from you, almost about a year ago, we took evidence from Audit Scotland on the report at that time, which was in advance of the census being carried out, and we then took evidence from the National Records of Scotland in January of this year, and they told us about and we had some exchanges with them about administrative data and how that would be used, and we were told that wouldn't be used to fill data gaps, but we learn after the census return rates that there will be administrative data used probably more heavily than originally anticipated. Could you tell us what the implication of that is for the quality of the census data that we will have?
Yes, convener, I think it is fair to say that administrative data, as Darcy describes, needs to be used more significantly in Scotland than had originally been planned as a result of the survey completion rates that we have now settled on of 89% in Scotland, marginally below the 90% target. But within that, there's a bigger story. So although, I think as we set out in the report, Scotland has 32 local authorities, the completion rate target was met in 30 of those local authorities, but there's quite significant regional variation. So, for example, in Glasgow, as we set out in the report, the completion rate is 83% in Scotland, in Glasgow. And therefore, there has to be other approaches brought in to give robust, reliable data. And administrative data forms one significant part of how to have reliable population estimates, which is where the survey programme needs to get to. For all the very important reasons that sit behind it. One last point I would make about administrative data. NRS has brought in advice and guidance to support the completion of the end of the project to that reliable position, International Steering Group. led by Cyrian Diamond, and Cyrian gave evidence to the Constitution Committee, and I think his judgment was that the overall arrangements are that they now have in place provide a solid foundation, I think his words, to produce robust, reliable population estimates. That's a process that NRS needs to go through, you know, over the course of 2023, and there's a very important role for their regulator, the Office for Statistical Regulation, who we know are working with NRS to arrive at that final point. But go back to your original point, Kamira, yes, administrative data will play a more significant part than had originally been planned.
Again, just can I be clear, are there or are there not more risks associated with relying on less primary data or more administrative data?
I'm not sure we're in a position to give you a definitive judgment on that. I think that's something that the primarily the regulator, the OSR, and the steering group, that they've said that this is not an inappropriate methodology for a compilation of robust population estimates, doesn't lead us to a point to say that's not an appropriate route for NRS to take. I think it is fair to say, Convener, that they didn't plan to have it this way, but it doesn't invalidate the overall results. Ultimately, if that will be the judgment of NRS and the OSR, if that's where they get to.
Okay. And you referred to this a few minutes ago. I mean, do you have a view, though, on the fact that a target of 90% return rate was set against a backdrop of a 97% return rate in the other parts of the UK? I mean, doesn't that lack ambition if other parts of the UK on a digital first census managed to achieve return rates of 97% virtually 12 months before? Why was the ambition only to get a 90% return rate?
If I may convene, I think part of that's NRS are probably better placed to answer, but I think from our analysis, even drawing on the 2011 survey results, Scotland's completion rate was lower than other parts of the UK. So Scotland's return rate was 94% then. Although, as you know, you rightly say that England and Wales, Northern Ireland, for this survey result, had a 97%. But drawing on other sources, we're seeing a reduction in household survey engagement and returns on surveys. And coming back to, you know, where does NRS go to next, you know, for the next iteration of the survey, I think it's becoming much more likely that wider sources of data will need to be used, not just in Scotland, but likely, you know, in other jurisdictions as well, to arrive at population estimates. Bearing in mind that, you know, the census methodology, the origins of it go back hundreds of years, when there was no alternative other than to do household door-by-door surveys. We do have alternatives in a broader suite of data. And, you know, certainly it's not for urban statisticians to make that judgment, but if the OSR judgment, along with the expert panel, is that that's likely to be the direction of travel, I think what matters is that, and where we get to in the report, is that that's transparently set out, and that people who will use the data, people who scrutinise at the Parliament, can have confidence that the overall end position still produces reliable estimates.
Okay. And do we know at this stage whether the next census will be in 10 years' time or 9 years' time?
We don't convene. I think that's, ultimately that will be a political choice in conjunction with NRS for the years to come.
Okay. Well, let me steer away from politics then and just ask a final question from me at this stage, which is, I mean, you may recall that we had some quite detailed conversations with NRS about their access to administrative data. And I think it was the case that the ONS had much more extensive access and to HMRC data, for example, and I think it was DWP data, but there was a much broader suite, which was as a result of agreements they had entered into. Now, we were told that those were not agreements for data sharing that were entered into for the sole purpose of the census. They were entered into for other reasons. But nonetheless, it meant that they had much wider access to much more comprehensive data than the National Records of Scotland had. And I think, you know, my recollection is that when we quizzed National Records of Scotland They said that they were looking at, I think, Scottish data sources to try to improve in a range of work that they do, the data access that they've got, but that they were still at quite an early stage in that. So I guess what the committee would be interested to learn, if you can help us with this, is the extent to which there has been any progress made in those data sharing agreements that were spoken about in January of this year.
Yeah, happy to start, and Darcy will want to say a bit more perhaps about some of the gatekeeping governance arrangements that exist and the progress that NRS is making to access those additional sources. At high level terms, convener, the NRS have identified a range of administrative data that, in their view, is necessary, along with taking the guidance of their international steering group, be it electoral registers, NHS registers, student data, and some school data. So all of that suggests that, you know, there's a clear path from NRS about what data needs to be sourced in order to ultimately get to that end result again of their reliable population estimates. So we're not detecting any of those kind of barriers that are in place, but ultimately people need to have confidence that their data is secure, is being used properly, and that it's consistent with the purposes that were originally intended. We can say a wee bit more if Darcy has more detail, but I think similarly if NRS also might be in a position just to update publicly and transparently as they've committed to do so. Darcy.
I'd just add that so NRS are working with the support of the steering group to get access or extended access to administrative data for the purposes of the census population estimates. And there are two panels that applications for access to statistical data sets have to go to. So there's the public benefit and privacy panel and for health and social care. And then there's a statistics public benefit and privacy panel that controls access to Scottish government data sets and also census data. So I think, as I understand it, NRS is hoping to have secured all the necessary permissions by the end of the calendar year. And they'll also have to come to data sharing agreements with the organisations which hold the data that they're looking to access. So that includes electoral register data, NHS register data about people who have registered with GPs, school pupil census, amongst others.
Sorry, Darcy, just for the record, so today's the 15th of December. Are you saying that within the next 2 weeks, are you saying, or is it the next calendar year you're talking about?
That's what this calendar year is, what NRS reported to the Census Programme Board in, I think, September. We haven't had any further updates on that, so NRS would be best placed to update you on whether they've actually been able to do that, secure those permissions or not.
Okay, well, I think obviously as a committee we'll need to consider whether we want to pursue that with them. Can I invite Willie Coffey to put some questions to you? Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Auditor General, before I ask a couple of questions about the work that's remaining to be done and some questions around the digital aspect of the census, could I ask, is there a standard, an industry standard or otherwise sort of percentage return rate that you should look to get a representative sample of the population in a thing like a census? What's the percentage figure, or is there none?
I'm not sure, Mr. Coffey. I'll maybe just turn to colleagues if we know the answer to that, if there's a reliable number, a threshold that must be reached. Given that there is variation between ambitions set in different parts of the UK, we can assume, as with any statistics, that there's a margin of confidence on some of those numbers. But I'll pause and just see if colleagues can support on that.
I'm not aware if there's a kind of industry standard, as it were, but we do know that NRS would consider that an overall response rate of at least 90% was what they were aiming for. They were hoping for 94% or above because that's what they got in 2011. But they considered 90% to be the sort of the target.
So I'm really curious about that because we talk about target rates and then response rates, and they're entirely different things. As we all know, the UK target wasn't 97%, it was 94%. But I'm curious about why we think we're significantly above or below something that we don't know that we're trying to reach to be a valid survey. And I note that in your report, Auditor General, you say that the census target response rate for Scotland's local authorities was 85%, and that was exceeded by responses. I also note that in the ONS report for the survey, the census survey carried out in England and Wales, that their target was 80% for local authorities in England and Wales. So my question is, why do you think there's a lower target for response rates for England and Wales compared to Scotland?
I feel that I may not be able to give you a satisfactory answer to that, Mr. Coffey, that actually the variations in the methodology and how robust they are probably more questions that NRS and ONS will be able to answer. I think what we've looked to do is to take a view about, well, did ONS ultimately for the spending of approaching £150 million of public money achieve the outcomes intended in terms of a robust survey that supports population estimates. What we, I think, if I may just kind of broaden out, in terms of the local authority completion rates, whilst they've achieved it in 30 out of 32 of Scotland's local authorities, there are still gaps to fill, and the NRS, together with the regulator, need to be satisfied that ultimately there are robust results. Regrettably, I'm not able to kind of give you a helpful answer in terms of the difference in methodologies between Scotland, England and Wales.
The point I'm trying to make, Convener, is that if you set the target lower and you exceed it significantly in response rate, it looks as though it's a better performance than you might otherwise expect. So the higher the target that you set, the more difficult it is to do that. Could I move on to another question in your report? In one of your key messages, you talk about the significant work that still remains to be done to ensure that the census delivers these robust population estimates and other outputs. Could you just tell us a wee bit more about what that work involves?
Yeah, happy to do that, actually. And Darcy may want to supplement any of my contributions. I think as we touched briefly with the convener, overall terms, NRS have identified that they have a gap in respect of the household survey results compared to their targets, and they have regional variations as well that requires them to bring in other sources, primarily that of the administrative data. That's the process that we understand that they are going through at the moment, Mr. Coffey, and will do over the course of 2023, with further reporting that year and then also into 2024 before they complete the overall programme that validated with the judgment of the regulator that these are robust, reliable population estimates. One of the, not just ourselves, actually, but some of the work of the OSR had earlier this year called in that programme of work to be done transparently so that Parliament, public have a clear understanding of the work that's being undertaken. And we've touched on in the paper that OSR have given a view that that is becoming a more transparent process from NRS. So effectively that, the analysis of the results together with filling in the remaining gaps with the use of administrative data is a brief summary of what NRS are currently undertaking.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. Could I turn to the digital aspect of the census and ask for your views on whether you think we were hampered in Scotland by the public's access to digital devices to complete the online survey. Maybe you could start by telling us what was the difference between this survey and this census and the last one. There was a big digital component and online component to this, and there wasn't the last time. Has that been a significant factor, do you think?
So I think there's a number of points in there. This was primarily an online survey that that households in Scotland chose, which to complete it with appropriate guidance and signals from NRS. That there were still many people in Scotland who chose or who requested a paper copy. Some 600,000 or so paper copies were issued, with half of those returned. But it is absolutely the case that Scotland has moved to almost an entirely digital survey. Your question about whether people were hampered in their ability to complete it by access, we've not analysed that yet. And I think going back to one of our key recommendations in the paper is that NRS, as part of its remaining work and evaluation, goes through that process to understand the choices that people made to complete the survey and why people didn't complete the survey. We've spoken with the committee through much of our recent reporting about access inequalities and so forth, and whether that was one of the key factors behind Scotland having a lower than anticipated return rate, and also what that means in terms of reliability of data. So that absolutely, Mr. Coffey, is a key responsibility now for NRS to understand what were the reasons, what barriers there were for household participation in surveys.
And do they look at variations in population about the level of access that people have to IT and skills and so on? I was well aware of that when I ran the cross-party group in digital exclusion convener. There was huge differences in even within Scotland of access to digital technology for people to do this. So despite their willingness to participate in the online world, there's still an issue about whether they actually can and do that. So will that further work try to investigate portions of the population that couldn't participate as fully as they might have wished to?
Yeah, I'll start. Actually, I'm sure Dasha might want to come in on this point as well. I think that's a really, really important process that NRS now goes through. And I've mentioned Glasgow a couple of times already in my responses. I don't think we've reached a view about whether or not it's if deprivation and digital exclusion, if there's a direct parallel between participation in the survey in an electronic context. But there are some telling indicators there about where deprivation exists in Scotland, and then the participation rates in the survey, digital or otherwise. Actually, and there'll be ultimately important lessons for NRS to learn, whether it's to be applied in however many years' time for future survey, but actually really any population survey that's undertaken has to think about how can people most easily participate to get reliable results. Darcy may wish that.
Yes, well, we don't know the exact details of what will be involved in NRS's kind of evaluation work, but we would expect them to be looking at issues of digital exclusion and how they could build to build on that in future censuses. But we do know that during the collection period, particularly in the extension period, they were targeting their field force efforts and support efforts to areas where they had identified that the response rate was lower, and that will hopefully have also picked up areas where people were digitally excluded or having issues with completing the census online. And obviously they had a helpline and other means to support people to either complete it online or to get access to paper copies of the census.
Okay, thanks very much for that, everybody. Thanks, convener.
Thanks very much indeed. I mean, anecdotally, one of the things that certainly I picked up around the time of the census was that people who didn't complete in one go the census, when they went to log back on, discovered they had to start right from the beginning. And I don't know whether that was a feature common to the systems that were applied in Wales, Northern Ireland, and England as well, and or whether that was a deficiency in the Scottish system which perhaps drove down the completion rate. Don't know whether you've picked that up at all.
I hadn't, convener. actually, but I think it's I can well understand why that would be a deterrent for people to re-engage with the survey. It feels like a really important area for NRS to investigate as part of their overall validation judgments that they've made on the programme.
Thank you. Right, I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie, who's got some questions. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Auditor General, I'd like to go back just to something you started to talk about previously. I think it was in the conversation with the convener. For the rest of the UK, England, Wales and so on, they had access to other databases which enabled them to boost the effective return levels of the census. Have you any idea what sort of percentage improvement was achieved because of that?
I'm maybe just checking my understanding of your question, Mr. Beattie. I'm not sure there's a direct relationship between using administrative data and the overall survey return rates. I think to say that it boosts the overall return rate, I think our understanding is that it's a parallel use of data to produce ultimately reliable population estimates, as opposed to say that administrative data equates to a percentage of return rate in lieu of members of the public not completing the survey. If I may, I'll just check that my understanding that's correct. Yeah, I think that's our understanding.
So it improves the quality of the return, not the quantity?
Correct.
Okay, that's good to know. In your report, you state that in order to improve the response rate, NRS field force staff offered support and assistance across Scotland, and particularly focused in areas that have lower response rates. Can you tell us which areas had lower response rates and what additional support that's referred to was actually given in these areas? Was it just more of the same or happy to do extra?
Yeah, happy to do that to the extent that we have that detail. And again, Darcy and Graham may wish to come in further. I've mentioned Glasgow a couple of times already this morning as being the council area with the lowest return rate of 83% in Scotland. In terms of what does that mean, actually, and I think there's connections with Mr. Coffey's line of questioning as well, that where there is access to or lack of access to digital devices, or whether it's a preference of a household, people were given the option to complete digitally or to complete in person. To support the completion rates, NRS employed a field force, temporary workers, to go around people's doors, to remind them of the importance of completing the survey, offer assistance where necessary, and follow that up with as required with additional visits. So effectively, quite a traditional, as indeed many of us will recall from surveys in previous decades, of actually going door to door to support, remind, encourage people to complete the survey.
Do we have any information, for example, in a place like Glasgow, whether any particular ethnic groups returned lower than others? Because it's quite important that we get that outreach.
Darcy might know. Before she comes in, I think it's an incredibly important part of the survey validation. So it's not just about getting up to a certain percentage of confidence, actually that the survey results are representative of society. Because if we're to get to robust population estimates, they have to be tested against a range of parameters. So in terms of protected characteristics, groups, all of which will drive funding formulas and the delivery of public services over the course of the next decade. It's also really important that all of that thinking is part of the methodology. Quality impact assessments need to feature really prominently as part of that assessment. I'll pause, Mr. Beattie, and just check with Darcy what further we can add.
We don't have information to hand about response rates among specific population groups. NRS should be aware of that, though, and be and part of their work, certainly during the extension period to the collection period, and also subsequently when it comes to the census coverage survey and the use of administrative data, is about filling in the gaps about the people that didn't respond. And that means that you have better data for those sort of smaller geographical populations and ethnic groups and so on that are harder to count, if you will. So that when OSR are reporting on NRS's efforts, I think in the new year, part of what they presumably will be looking at will be checking that they do have that robust data for the smaller populations.
So what you're saying is the data does exist, but it's just not available to yourself at the moment.
I assume that NRS will have that, but we don't currently.
Yeah, I think that's right. We don't know that precisely yet. I think it's a reasonable assumption to make that within the data and the analysis and evaluation that follows, that NRS, together with the International Steering Group and the judgments made by the regulator, will be going through that process. Ultimately, all of these factors will be combined to reach a judgment towards the end of next year and into 2024 that Scotland, as a result of the census, has reliable population estimates. Population estimates include all of that analysis that you referred to in terms of ethnicity and other characteristics, Mr. Beatty.
Now, you've referred to Glasgow as a particular area which has had a lower response rate. Are there other areas of significance where similar patterns emerged?
So, at a headline level, Scotland had met its target rate that NRS set for 30 out of 32 local authorities, the target being 85% completion. But I think within that, I think that only tells part of the story. So, you know, we mentioned Glasgow, which is below that target, but I think it probably follows on from your previous question. That doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to produce reliable population estimates. It flows into, well, what comes next in terms of the evaluation? Do they have reliable data for different parts of society, whether it's Scottish instance of multiple deprivation data for at least the funding formulas, different ethnicity, all the associated flow of funds. And that takes us really back to, well, alongside the survey results, plus the administrative data is the route through to get to robust, reliable data. For us at the moment, I think we're reporting what NRS have got to at this stage. There is considerable work to be done over the course of the next year so that by local authority and by different groups across Scotland that it can produce that reliable population data.
Now, your report also states that the NRS is investigating or continuing to investigate the reasons for the lower than expected response rate, and also why it was lower in comparison to other countries. Are you aware of how they're doing this and what progress they're making and whether there's a target date involved in this?
So I think we're aware of this up to a point, actually, and again, colleagues can come in and say a bit more. At an overall level, establishing the International Steering Group was a positive thing to do because it's given NRS access to experts in the use of data, and alongside that, some of the behaviours of public as to why they will or won't participate in surveys. Cyrene Diamond, you know, has in his evidence to the Constitution, Culture and Europe Committee, had talked about some of the change in behaviours and the extent of the public's engagement with surveys being lower than they have historically been. All of that is part of the work that NRS are currently undertaking, and you know, we, in our own report, encouraging that's reported publicly, transparently, just about here are the lessons from the 2021 survey and what that means, not just for the next survey, but actually for future surveys. I think it's safe to say, Mr. Beattie, that people's behaviours are changing to the extent that, you know, they'll willingly comply and engage with survey activity. So for NRS and other survey organisations, that they have a range of tools at their disposal, administrative data, online survey, paper-based survey, that they can have as broad a reach as possible. All that's part of NRS's work for the year to come.
You've not actually mentioned anything about timescales or actual progress.
Yeah, two things. The work of the Office for Statistical Regulation is due to publish a report towards the end of 2023 on their work with NRS on population estimates. And then NRS have publicly committed, I think it was confirmed by the Cabinet Secretary, to produce a report in 2024 on some of the evaluation lessons learned from this survey. These are quite important milestones to satisfy the Parliament and the public about the assessment of this survey result. I'll stop in case there's anything Darcy wishes to add.
Just to say that the full evaluation report is due to be laid before Parliament as the census programme comes to an end, and that should be in 2024. And that evaluation is supposed to look at the entire scope of the census, including the design and the operational elements of the census collection period, along with all the subsequent sort of statistical methodology and the processing of the data and the output. So it should cover the whole programme.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. At this point, I'm going to bring in the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie. Sharon.
Good morning. Paragraph 12 explains that programme costs are estimated to increase by £6 million in 2022-23, and the report goes on to state that the actual figure will not be known until the end of 2022-23, and that this will need to be carefully managed. What are the risks if the costs are not carefully managed, and do you have any concerns?
I'll bring Graeme in a moment, actually, just to say about the audit work that we've undertaken in the past year on the spending to date. As we set out in the paragraph, that costs increased by about £6 million this year, and we analysed that a little bit more closely in terms of additional supplier costs of £3 million, £1.7 million for further field staff, and then just over an additional million for the census coverage survey. There are risks do remain in terms of additional spending on top of the further costs that we discussed with the committee last year as a result of the extension. But I don't think we're talking about the scale of additional spending that we had been as a consequence of the planned delay given the pandemic. But nonetheless, I think given that the project has cost around £27 million more than had originally been intended, it matters that these costs are still kept under close review. They're managed to keep further public spending to a minimum as a result of the project. I'll bring in Graeme in case he just wants to share with the committee any of those arrangements that NRS are using.
Thank you. NRS do monitor the census spend very regularly, reporting to their committees and board, and it is something that we look at as part of the audit to test the expenditure on the census and to confirm that it is being closely monitored and scrutinised during the year. They have managed to achieve that in recent years. It is kept very close to budget. They're managing it well. As the Auditor General mentioned, the extra expenditure of £6 million for 22-23, they were originally given up to £9 million extra, but have reduced that down to only estimating that they'll need £6 million. So I would say they are monitoring it closely and will need to continue to do so.
Thank you. Moving on to paragraph 15, page 6 of the report states that as the census programme progresses through its later stages, it's important that NRS has knowledge transfer plans in place to build on the skills it has in-house. Do you know what action NRS is taking to ensure this happens?
colleagues can update if we have kind of detailed insight as to the specifics that NRS are undertaking. Before bringing Graham or Darcy in, we make this comment in a lot of reports when we talk about IT arrangements within the public sector and guarding against the risk that absolutely public bodies need to bring in expert services where they're undertaking a project, that they wouldn't require those services on a rolling day-to-day basis. Don't employ them on a permanent contract per se. One of the risks that we've seen over the years is that once the design or build phase ends, contractors leave the organisation, and then that expertise and skills that the public sector has paid significant sums for goes with the contractor. So it's something that they need to guard against, but within reason, so that it's not, they're not going to be in, undertaking the survey year after year. But NRS is a largely digital organisation, so seeing that those skills remain and that expertise that they've paid for remains in the organisation is really important. We expect it will be part of their evaluation of the survey, but in terms of the steps that they're taking, I'll just ask Graham if there's anything further that he can share.
Thank you. I don't think I have any further details around that. As the Auditor General says, there is a large use of temporary staff during the census project. It is something that we have commented on in our annual audit reports in recent years, but it is the nature of the work that staff are only needed for a short period of time, and it is something that they will need to look into, just how that knowledge is transferred, but don't have any more detail around the arrangements.
Okay, thanks. I'm now going to turn to Craig Hoy, who's got some questions to put. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Paul. I suppose as we approach Christmas, we should be reminded that censuses are nothing new. The Romans were conducting them every 5 years, over 2,000 years ago. I want to reflect on what happened in the most recent census in England and in Scotland. Obviously, there's a report out last week from the ONS, which is entitled Maximising the Quality of the Census 2021 Population Estimates, obviously relating to the census south of the border. And one of the main conclusions and points that the ONS refers to is that, and I quote, our planned flexible approach to collection and well-tested response strategy enabled us to respond to changing circumstances such as the coronavirus pandemic. So, focusing on the words that they said, planned flexible approach to collection and a well-tested response strategy, have you looked at what happened in England in relation to Scotland to find out what was more flexible in the UK census as opposed to Scotland, and how the well-tested response strategy in England differed to what was taking place here in Scotland?
We haven't done that work, but I think that's exactly the type of analysis and reflections that NRS will be doing or ought to be doing over the course of the next 12 months as part of its evaluation of the completion of Scotland's census for 2022. Not just about how it went, but whether there were any opportunities to apply and into different approaches next time round, and absolutely to learn from other jurisdictions. The fact that they've appointed an international steering group suggests that they are open and ready to bring that learning into future surveys in Scotland.
The international steering group. I note that NRS isn't represented on that group. Is there any particular reason as to why the NRS isn't formally represented within the group?
I think that's potentially quite a helpful thing, that rather than the body themselves, being seen to have undue influence on the views of experts, that they are drawing on that independently. That is led by the national statistician, Sirian Diamond, and gives it a reach and a credibility to support NRS. And I think it's also important to say that we know that NRS are engaging well with their regulator in terms of the overall population statistics. So I think all speaks to they have got a range of sources of expertise to inform judgments about this survey and where they go next.
Yeah, obviously the census in England proceeded on the timetable as planned, and it was delayed in Scotland. Have you as of yet been able to make any preliminary judgment as to whether or not the decision to delay meant that we actually improved the data capture rate in Scotland, or for some reason might that actually have impeded the management of the census?
I think reflecting back to the previous report is that, you know, NRS, together with the Scottish Government, took a view that they wouldn't have been able to progress to a point that they would have produced reliable population estimates by undertaking the survey in 2021. So the decision to delay, in their view, was absolutely necessary so that Scotland produces reliable population estimates, albeit with the delay as a consequence. We remember that the committee explored this with NRS in the evidence session. Convener, you've already referred to the discussion that you've had about administrative data and NRS's methodology compared to that of ONS. At the risk of labouring the point, Mr Hoy, I think that's effectively where they're at now, and the work that they need to undertake over the course of the next 12 months is to do that analysis to support learning for reflections from this survey, that what that means for the methodology into the next survey. I'm sure this will absolutely be the case for NRS, but you know, given the fact that surveys take place every 10, 11 years, changes in behaviour, technology are moving at such a pace that whatever lessons are learned from this survey will undoubtedly need to be refreshed in the intervening period in anticipation of the future significant public surveys in Scotland.
And in terms of the use and the impact of the Scottish census data, you obviously, in discussion with Mr Coffey, looked at the digital issue and then the issue in perhaps the hardest to reach areas, those with the highest incidence of deprivation. Given that those are the areas perhaps where government bodies need that data to be able to obviously work out what policy instruments are going to be deployed, is there now a risk that actually, unless we focus in on those areas, the hard-to-reach areas where there was a lower response rate, we may actually have a problem moving forward addressing the societal and social need and economic need in those areas?
There's a risk if that doesn't go well. But I think it's a key focus. Certainly, we know that the OSR are very alert to that risk, and that's a key part of their discussions with NRS. So exactly the discussion we've touched on already this morning, that it's not just about getting to a particular number in terms of survey returns. It's the analysis that sits beneath that for different parts of society that produces ultimately reliable population estimates. We're very clear that NRS, the regulator, the International Steering Group, are very focused on that point.
Just a final point, really, just in terms of clarification, really. The report states that the International Steering Group concluded that extending the census coverage survey would have a negative impact on subsequent stages of the census programme. Perhaps, Darcy, I'm not sure you want to come in on this. Do you know what these negative impacts were likely to have been?
I think it's just in terms of timescales and making sure that they were able to produce outputs, which they're aiming to get first outputs published a year from the end of the collection period. So essentially, if they had extended the census coverage survey, that would then have a knock-on effect on their ability to produce outputs.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, unless any members of the committee have got any final questions, and I see Colin Beattie indicating that he does have, I'll bring you in.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick one, actually, for a clarification. On paragraph 15, you indicate that 42% of overall staff costs consist of temporary staff. Now, the explanation given for that is obviously the census, which must be a major part, and also specialist IT projects. I'd be interested in knowing what the split between these two are.
I'll check with Graham if we have that information at our disposal. If not, we can come back to the committee in writing. Graham?
It's not something that I readily know, but we can check and see if we have additional information about that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much indeed. And there may be elements here that we need to follow up both with yourselves and also with NRS, I think, arising from the evidence that we've taken. But I am going to draw the public part of the meeting to a close. But before I do that, can I thank our witnesses this morning, Darshi Sansa Kumaran, Graeme Sampson and Auditor General Stephen Boyle. Thank you very much for your evidence this morning, and I will now move the committee into private session.